Welcome to Geocache Adventures, the podcast where we explore everything geocaching. I'm your host, Shadow Dragon One. I love geocaching. If you're listening to this, you probably love it too. If you enjoy the podcast, consider sharing it with somebody that you think would love it. You can also follow the podcast on Instagram and Facebook, and there's a Facebook group as well, so you can join in the fun and share your adventures. There's also a Patreon page that you can join and unlock exclusive content. Hey everybody, Amy Shadow Dragon One here, and with me today is Brian Roth, co-founder and president of Groundspeak. Thank you so much for joining me today.
It is my pleasure to be here. Hi everybody.
So I like to start off asking my guest, how did you get started geocaching?
Oh boy. I'll do the abbreviated version because it's a long story. But the abbreviated version is that I was working at a .com many, many years ago, a little over 23 years ago, with Jeremy and Elias, and a friend of ours named Michael Schmidt brought a GPS into the office that he had gotten for his birthday. And we were, you know, fascinated with the technology, you know, hooking into a multi-billion-dollar satellite system. And Jeremy kind of went outside, and on the map, you can see, you know, there was the little breadcrumb trail. It was a little yellow Garmin eTrex. And he said, oh, wow, this is really cool, this, you know, positioning technology. And he went online to see, you know, I wonder what else you can do with this. And he found the satellite GPS news group. Saw Dave Ulmer's post about having, you know, placed the original stash, and he decided he was going to buy a GPS, and he did, and he went out and he had a geocaching experience where he ended up with like a Saturn, like that kind of car, on logging roads, and ended up in clear cut and got attacked by bugs, and he had a puppy with him, and he ran out of water, and but he said when he found this little card box, it was like a eureka moment. Like, here I am in the middle of nowhere, and I found something that somebody else had placed, and it's, you know, the part of the secret club. And so he drove back to the office, or drove back to Seattle, and the next week he came in and he told me and Elias about it and others. And he's like, you know, it's this really cool hobby. It's just getting started. And he's an extremely talented developer. And he said, I think I could build a website to make it easier for people to play and for people to be better prepared, like he wasn't. And he did that. He set about building the website. And, you know, around September of 2000, September 3rd, to be precise, launched geocaching.com when Mike Teague's site went down, and Mike Teague told everybody to go see geocaching.com. And Jeremy approached Elias and said, hey, I need some help. I think I should start a company to support this. You know, let's get me, you, and Brian together, because between the three of us, we can do all, you know, all different things. He was a developer. Elias was like network infrastructure and hardware. I was doing legal and business development and HR. And so a lot of the non-technical things. We decided to form a company. We were incorporated. Well, so I created my account, I think it's September 27th of 2000, and my account number is like 172, which is actually, you know, Jeremy is, I think, number three or whatever. Nobody, there was no number one or number two. And mountain bike, John Stanley, is number 24. So John actually had a geocaching account before me. He was an early adopter, obviously. And then the first time I went geocaching, we had already incorporated. I did all the legal paperwork and filing. We were a company. And I want to say that I probably, and the caveat, don't anybody at home do this. I think I hid my first cache before I actually found my first cache. At least that's what the stats tell me. I really don't remember because it's been 23 years. But you ready for this? December 25th of 2000, I think it's GC125. I don't remember. I think that that's it. I'm not 100% sure. But I hid the first geocache in Mexico.
Oh,
Christmas
wow.
Day of 2000. And it was, I think it was only found twice. The first person to find it was like an American Airlines pilot who was in Mexico, and he's like, I just heard about this game and I saw that there was one a quarter of a mile down the beach. And you know, I think in hindsight, I really didn't know what I was doing, but I had a GPS, I had the coordinates, I put a box and a logbook that, you know, my mom bought it at a Mexican grocery store, and I think I put a bottle of rum in the cache, which obviously don't do that, you know. Hey kids, don't do that at home. Well, obviously, you shouldn't have access to rum anyway, but that's what I did. And the cache, I think it was muggled after maybe two finds or something like that. But I did hide the first cache in Mexico, so you know, I didn't even know that until, I don't know, 3 or 4 years ago when we came out with like the cache owner's dashboard. I was like, oh yeah, I forgot about that. And you know, I wrote to Mountain Bike, coincidentally, and I was like, hey, this cache, like, is this the first cache in Mexico? And he's like, yeah. And I was like, all right, that's pretty cool. It wasn't a great cache. Anyway, and then if anybody's got the Complete Idiot's Guide to Geocaching books, there's a picture of me, Jeremy, Elias, and my old dog who's long since passed away. And that was one of the first times that was the first time that we ever went caching together. And we went
Wow.
caching in Seattle. We found a cache called Toy Discovery, and there were a couple of others in the area. And that was kind of how I got into geocaching, like just happenstance, discovery, and coincidence, and all that. And you know, here we are 23 plus years later, and it's been a really cool journey.
That is really cool. So you kind of went into some about how the website came about and everything. How did you guys get Groundspeak off the ground?
Well, first of all, it wasn't called Groundspeak when we started. It was called Grounded Inc. And then there was a point, I don't remember, it was probably a year or so in, we were out to lunch, and we were sitting around and we were talking about just future plans and sort of vision. And it was like, oh, you know, this game can bring life to locations. And we came up with this idea, and I don't remember which came first, but it was like ground speak, like if as if the ground could speak and tell its share its stories or share the beauty of the location. So that was ground speak. And at the same time, we came up like ground speak is the language of location. And so, you know, the language of location was like an original trademark of ours. It used to say that on the website. You know, this we don't really say that too much anymore, but it was Groundspeak, the language of location. I'm going to show you something that I guess, I don't know if anybody can see, and it's fading a little bit, so I have it face down. But this is the cocktail napkin that says the language of location and Groundspeak under it.
Oh.
That was from that date. And unfortunately, I didn't put a date on it when we wrote, you know, who knew that it was going to be something, but it was just, oh, here's this idea, like let's change the name of the company to Groundspeak. We thought it was cooler, and like Groundspeak as a, you know, oh, Groundspeak is the language of location. We thought that that was cool. So that's the little cutout, and it's fading, and I dare say it won't last another 23 years, but our goal is to make sure that this company lasts well more than another 23 years.
That's pretty cool. So, needless to say, a lot has developed in geocaching over that 23 years. What
Indeed.
are you most proud of other than the start of the company? Let's rule that one out.
Well, I'll say, you know, for the start of the company, like how we got it off the ground, I don't think I did a good job of answering that. So just briefly, I'll say that the dot-com we were working at crashed and burned with the rest of them in the very late 90s. And we all went to work for a promotional marketing company called Sunrise Identity at the time. And that was our day job. And so I was there as like general counsel for 5 years while we worked on this company for free. So we weren't getting paid, but we did it because when Jeremy and Elias first approached me, they said, hey, listen, here's what we're doing. You know, we're all outdoor enthusiasts. We're all, you know, fans of technology. And, you know, we could do all these different things together. Between the three of us, we could get a company started. And Jeremy said at the time, he's like, there's no money in it, but it's this really cool hobby. And, you know, together, maybe we can get more people outside. And so I was like, I already knew them, and they're both like brilliant in different ways, but they're really both brilliant. I mean, the sort of the proof is in the pudding. You've seen what they've put together, obviously with some help from me and countless others over the years, and community volunteers and all that. But I said, I just want to work with you guys. I love the idea of doing that. So we worked for free for 5 years until we were able to hire ourselves. We hired Jeremy first, then we brought Elias on, and then we hired an illustrator and a couple more developers and like a community person. And it's not like we need a full-time lawyer when we're a small business. And we had some business development, but we were doing work nights and weekends for the first 5 years. That's how we kind of got it off the ground. And then there was a time where Jeremy said, like, hey guys, we're doing a lot of work on this. Like, we either need to sell this to somebody who can work on it full time, or we need to find a way to make money so that we don't have to have day jobs. And that's when, we were already selling t-shirts, we were selling some trackables, but we came up with the idea of a premium membership and a charter membership. And we went to the community and we said, hey, everybody, like, help us support this game. $30 a year, access to advanced features and functionality, of which there is none yet, but give us a chance and we'll add some stuff. And that month, it was February of, I don't know, 01, 02, the dates elude me a little bit. We got about $28,000. And
Wow.
that's kind of what we said is, wow, oh my goodness. And so the next month wasn't even close to that. It was like, $1,500, because everybody who was like in was like, okay, I'll support this. And that the next month was much, much smaller, but we said, okay, we can use this to pay some of our bills. And over the course of the next few years, we were getting more premium subscribers, we were selling more merchandise, and we got to the point where, admittedly, with a pretty substantial pay cut, we were able to pay ourselves. And we said, okay, let's quit the day jobs, let's focus on this full time. And then over the course of the last 23 years, now we've got 95 full-time employees who we take very good care of. We've got a group of community volunteers that give so much to the game and the community, all around the world. I would say, to your question of what I am most proud of, I'll say that, first of all, it's a pride that doesn't just belong to me. It is shared with everybody that's ever hidden a cache, every community volunteer who's reviewed caches or helped a new player or worked with landowners or worked with, land management agencies around the world, or the people that have moderated forums or translated the website or called their local newspaper and said, hey, you've got to see this cool thing that I'm doing. And so together, what we have done is we've built a global community where everybody is welcome. Everybody's welcome to come play. We can get together regardless of our backgrounds or politics or ideologies or whatever, and we can get together and we can share this game together. And I think that it's a really good example for the world. When you have there's so many things in the world that are set up intentionally or not to divide us from one another. And here we have this global game that actually brings people together. And it brings more joy to people's lives. And so basically, what I think we can all be proud of as a global community is that we're inspiring people to get outside. We're inspiring them to leave their couches and televisions behind and go out into the real world and have experiences and adventures that will enrich their lives and the lives of others. And that is something that is absolutely remarkable and something that should be celebrated by everybody who's participating.
Yeah, it's pretty incredible, especially this day and age of technology being so intense and so everywhere. And like I'm sure you have the same thing. You spend at least 8 hours a day working on a screen.
At least.
Yeah.
And really, it's here we are leveraging technology to get people outside instead of staring more at screens. And obviously, there's some staring at a screen when you're outside looking for a geocache, but it's a lot different than sitting on your couch and, not getting up for 3 hours because you're doom scrolling or whatever they call it, on TikTok or Facebook Reels or Instagram stories or whatever else they're going to put in front of us next. And so we had this old video, and I've looked for it a number of times, and I cannot find it, and I don't know how I'll ever find it. But it was an old cartoon that was done by our illustrator. Her name's Kokoro Kimura, and she was a Japanese illustrator. She was hired in the early days basically to illustrate for the website, and she was the original designer of Signal the Frog. And one of the things that she created was a video of, not a video, but almost like an animation of, it had this like pale-faced child sitting on a couch with a TV, and like the eyes were kind of glassy, but there was a chain connecting the child to the couch, and like Signal busts in the door and breaks the chain and like drags the kid outside. And it was like, in a way, it's like that's what we're trying to do. Obviously, that's exaggerated, but that was the video. And if I ever find it someday, we'll share it more broadly. But it was something that always stuck with us as like, hey, this is part of our mission. This is part of what we're doing as a company, as a global community. This is part of the reason that you've got a podcast, and that the reviewers are spending time reviewing caches or translating the website or the mobile app so that people in their country can also participate in this game. And it's something that, make no mistake, we could never do this alone. There's no company that could do this alone. It really takes a community, and that's the most special part of the whole thing.
Did you ever imagine it becoming this big?
No, I didn't. But not because, I think the reason I would say I didn't imagine it, or maybe we didn't imagine it, is we never actually sat down and said, what's this going to be in 20 years? Or what's it going to be in 15 years or even 10 years? It was more about, what do we need to do next? Like, it was constantly evolving, constant change, constant learning. So it was never clear like what's going to happen next. It was like, if you asked me at any point in the history of this company, if you asked me today, I would say the same thing. Like, what do we want to do? Where do we want to be in 5 years or 10 years? Those the common interview questions. And the short answer is, we want to be doing more of what we're doing today. We want to continue to leverage technology and the creativity of a global community to inspire outdoor adventure, exploration, and community. That's what we want to do. And so, if 5 years from now we're doing twice as much as we're doing today, great. That's a step in the right direction. If we're doing five times what we're doing today, even better. Something let you know, if we're doing less in 5 years than we're doing today, well then that's unacceptable. That's a failure, because we know that we can do more, and we know that technology is constantly changing. There is no shortage of ideas. There's really just a shortage of like, how much can we do in any given day? And there's a lot of people working really hard at HQ every day to try and shore up the systems and the technology and build more features and optimize, presentation, and build things like Adventure Lab or the future ideas that we'll be bringing to the community over the course of the next few years. So we're thinking about things like, what do we want to do next? How else can we approach this? How else can we move in the direction of achieving more of the mission? And it just takes time and effort and resources. And so that's what we'll be doing for the next 5 years. Where we'll end up, it's a big TBD.
Do you guys have like company brainstorming sessions to kind of help figure out some of these ideas for the future? Or, do people just email ideas to you? How does that work out for you?
It's a bit of everything. It really is. Like, everybody here cares about the game. We're paying attention. We're playing also. And so we're learning things like, oh, it would be better if it did this, or this is a little confusion. We should fix this. But in terms of like how we come up with new ideas, a lot of it is paying attention, Being in the Facebook groups and seeing what's happening on TikTok and Instagram and social, and getting emails from community members. Some of it just comes from ideas here. There's been more than a few, like, sleep well at night and wake up and it's like, oh my goodness, I dreamt about this idea. Like, we should try this. And it's not easy to say, like, oh, here's the idea, go build it tomorrow. It's more like, here's the idea, when will we have time to approach this? And some of it never gets done, and some of it takes, longer, and some of it takes shorter. But through all of those methods, we're looking at what is it that we're going to do next. And we have a product development team that is doing A/B testing and surveys and interviews of people, user interviews and people who have never played the game interviews, and really just trying to gather as much data and insight to help us understand, what is it that we're doing, what opportunities exist to do it better, what opportunities exist to bring novelty to the game, or new technology, leverage new technology to bring about new styles of gameplay, ultimately with the goal of getting more people outside playing.
So recently we had the partnership with GeoGuessr. How did that come about?
That was a project that was worked on with our partnerships team. And I want to say I can't tell you with certainty the origination of that partnership, but I believe that we got an email from GeoGuessr saying, like, hey, wouldn't it be cool if we could find a way to work together? And then we've got some active geocachers on our partnership team, and they said, oh, here's what you do, here's what we do. How can we combine this in a way that, when we talk about partnerships, we always talk about win-win-wins. And so it has to be priority one. It has to be something that's good for the community. It has to be something that players are going to enjoy. And, that doesn't always work, but that's our goal. And then it has to be something that is good for us as a business and good for our partner. So if we can create win-win-wins, great. If we can't, then it's no deal. And we walk away from a lot of things that's like, hey, if the we don't want to do anything that's like gonna extract value from the community without delivering value. That's we don't want to be that kind of company. We never want to be that kind of company. And so we really have to consider thoughtfully, how can we put this together in a way that really feels right? And that one, I when it came out, I went and played it, and I was like, oh, this is really cool. Like, I recognize some of these places, and I didn't do all that well at it. I think it's an art form, and I've seen the folks on YouTube who are like looking at an image, and they're like, oh, this is the spot in like Cape Town, South Africa, and I'm like, how do you even know that? But I thought it was pretty cool, and the reception from the community was really positive. And I think the folks on the GeoGuessr community got exposed to geocaching. And so it was like this cross-pollination, like, hey, everybody's, we're all passionate about like location and gaming and whatever. And maybe just by exposing people to geocaching and exposing people to GeoGuessr, we give more people opportunities to find fun in the world and ways to play.
Okay. So you've done partnerships with NASA and different trackable partnerships, like with Nickelodeon and SpongeBob. So is it more often companies reaching out to groundspeak to partnership, or do you also reach out to other companies to form partnerships?
We do some outreach. It's really limited. I would say we have a lot more success when people reach out to us. And I think that in part that is because a lot of people still, it's we like to say like it's the biggest hobby in the world that most people don't know about. And so like if we, if we call a big company and we're like, hey, we'd love to do a partnership with you, we're geocaching. If we're not talking to somebody who knows what geocaching is, that's pretty heavy lift to get them to like not only understand, but to like show up with budget and creativity and effort to put something together. However, when people find out about geocaching, they're like, oh, if they truly understand it, and like, here's this outdoor technology-oriented community of families and retirees and young people, and such a broad demographic of just really good people all over the world. They're like, oh, what can we do together? And then we get the email. It's like, hey, we're so-and-so company. We see what you guys are doing. We'd love to find a way to partner. Will you talk to us? And then the conversation is much easier because we could say, okay, you already know what we're doing. We don't have to start from like, well, it's a global game of like treasure hunting, but it's also like hide and seek. And there's 3.4 million boxes hidden all around the world. And like, here's how all this stuff works. So starting out from some level of understanding when they're coming to us makes things just a whole lot easier. We have done some outreach, but again, I think the most success comes from people reaching out to us because there's already some interest there. It's very strange to try and sell people on geocaching because we're not like, I don't want to say like used car salesmen, but we're not selling the game. We're kind of sharing the game. And so just asking people for money or whatever to put together, like some of these promotions have real hard costs. Like Unite for Diabetes, we produced 20,000 trackables and we sent them to people all around the world. And that was a really expensive promotion, but we had a grant from a pharmaceutical company who was interested in generating diabetes awareness and sharing with people the ways to, eating healthy and exercise are ways to like combat diabetes. So, there was a lot of good stuff going in there. And we said like, hey, providing education on diabetes is something that is good for the world. It's good for people. The geocachers really enjoy the trackable promotions. Here's a company who's going to help us pay for it because we're a bootstrap company, which is basically like, we've never taken any outside funding. We don't have debt because we're not looking to be bought. We're not looking to do an IPO. We're looking to do this. And so thanks to support from a lot of premium members around the world, we're able to have a business giving back without having to like try and extract the maximum amount of money for anybody and, things like that. And so that gives us a lot of flexibility as a company. And so, for example, we had the price increase last June. And I think in a traditional business environment, we see it all the time. Like if you have Netflix, which a lot of people like me do, it's like every 6 months, it's like, hey, we're raising the price. Like, have a nice day. If you want Netflix, we're raising the price. And what we did is we said like, hey, the cost of everything has gone up. We didn't change the cost of premium membership for 22 years. And we always felt like, hey, this is fair, but now everything is getting more expensive. And one of our primary goals is to have the company around for generations to come, for our kids and their kids' kids and whatever. Like, so we have a duty to this community to maintain Groundspeak as a going concern, as an ongoing business. And so what we said is, okay, we're not in trouble, but we need to raise prices somewhat so that we can continue to keep up with the rising cost of business and continue investing in the platform and, hiring talented employees who can come in and, talented lackeys to come and contribute more to the platform and the game and the community. But we said, we don't have to do it like Netflix or Spotify. We don't, and so what we said was, hey, we wouldn't be here if not for the premium members. So let's make a decision that's not necessarily in the best financial interest. We're not going to maximize the revenue, but what we're going to say is, hey, if you're a premium member and you've been supporting us, we're going to let you keep the $30 a year price or 30 euros. If you're a basic member and you really want to be a premium member, well, if you sign up between now and June 6th or whatever it was last year, we're gonna let you stay with this price also, and everybody else going forward after that, then it's gonna go to $39.99 from $29.99. And so it was a way for us to make a financial decision, but in a way that still recognizes like the duty of care and loyalty that we have for the community and the support that we've received over 23 years that have allowed us to do what we've done. And I think that that's a real benefit of being a bootstrap company. We always say around here, we don't have to answer to anybody. There's no big company that's going to say, you have to do this or charge more or change this. The only people we have to answer to are the members of the geocaching community and ourselves. And we want to be able to sleep at night. So we're always trying to do the right thing. Look, 23 years, like I could give you a long list of mistakes that we've made and projects that we've released that just, were mistakes or weren't ready or didn't deserve to see the light of day that ultimately are no longer around, for example. But that's how you learn. That's how you get better. That's how we've made it to here. And the mistakes can ultimately make us stronger. Don't get me wrong, we don't want to make the next mistake, but we have a there's a sign in Jeremy's old office that says, "Let's make better mistakes tomorrow." And that's that's it's one of the mantras here is let's hey, if we're gonna make a mistake, it's inevitable that we will. Let's learn as much from it as we can so that we can be a stronger company tomorrow than we are today.
I like that. That's a good attitude. Okay, so something that I've been very curious about, how are new cache types created?
Oh boy. It's rare.
Right.
Excuse me. It is rare. We really have to, I would say historically, it has come from paying attention to how people are playing and saying, how can we embrace this? How can we unlock future value by adding a cache type? It is not easy to do because, we have code that's 20 something years old. Not all of it, but there's legacy code that's intermixed. And so,
Yeah.
and there's also dependencies. There are third-party applications, there's APIs, there's dedicated GPS devices that aren't being updated anymore. And if we add something, like, does it break a system? We've talked about, as an example, Earth caches. The GSA, Gary Lewis, came to us and he said, "Hey, I've got this idea of like providing geology education, geological education through geocaching, and here's how it can work." And we're like, "All right, we're going to need help doing this. We need to come up with guidelines. We need sort of ultimately we need to find geo-awares, and we're going to have to do the technology piece." And so it was a tremendous amount of work to do it, but it made sense at the time, and we did that. Having cash in, trash out events was like, oh, we're already doing cash in, trash out. Maybe if we have events, we can actually have people do more big cleanups and really have a more positive impact on our environment. I'll say we were looking a few years ago, we were looking at the possibility of having like an AR cache type, augmented reality. And we did some experiments with some AR platforms and integrating them into the game. And we were using like HP Reveal was one of them. I don't remember the other. There was like three platforms when we started. It became two, and we were using we were using Google Poly, which gave us 3D animated objects. And then Google shut down Google Poly, and then HP Reveal went away, and all of a sudden it just became really difficult to do that. And we said, given the experience that we've seen so far and our ability to, focus time and energy on this project, this doesn't make sense for us to do it right now. In some ways, we don't want to add AR just as a novelty. We want to add features and functionality that really impact the game in a positive way. And so it was something that we just decided, hey, we're not ready to do that. And we may choose to revisit it at some point in the future, or we may choose to look at what's the next piece of technology that comes out. What do we want to do with AI? It's certainly conversations that we've had around here. There's a lot of ideas, but like choosing ideas is not the most difficult part. The most difficult part is executing and building things and creating the business rules and A/B testing and making sure what works and what doesn't work and what's confusing and what's not confusing and do people actually like this or are we just or is it just window dressing that's not really all that helpful. So when it comes to new cache types, it's rare. I mean, and it's going to be rare because there's so many factors that go into those kind of decisions. The decisions first and foremost, but then even the execution is, it's a substantial amount of work.
Sounds like it. There's been a couple instances where credits for virtual caches have been granted to different cachers to put out some new virtual caches. Will there is it possible that we may see something similar with webcam caches?
Yes. Yes, it's absolutely possible. I won't say that it's imminent. Like, I don't expect to see it anytime in the next, in the next few months. I could tell you that, as far as I know, and I probably know, like, we're not actively working on that now, but there have been plenty of conversations around here about doing that. I'm personally in favor of it. I really like webcams. They're few and far between. There's certainly not a lot of geographic diversity with webcams. I think that the foundation that we've built with the virtual rewards program has been really, really effective in getting virtuals out there in the right way and not sort of in the original way, which was just fraught with problems. We have the Back in the day when we first had virtuals, like, people could create them, without much thought. And it was like, come see this tree in my front yard, or there's an old, dirty boot out in the woods. How many laces on the boot? And like, that's like the quintessential example is like the old boot in the woods. And it's like, why, that's not a good experience. And so we really had to rein it in. And so we made them a legacy cache type for a while. And we said, all right, we're not going to have virtuals. And like, oh, we have waymarking and you can do some of that stuff there. But ultimately, it was bring back virtuals was one of the things that we heard from the community for many, many years. And ultimately, our community department basically said, hey, we have an idea of how we can do this. And that idea has been refined now over four iterations. And the first iteration was like, hey, we're giving virtual rewards. Here's how it's going to work. I don't remember the exact details, but it was far from perfect. There were challenges. There were frustrations. Oh, I should get one. This isn't fair. Or, and ultimately we've refined it so that the most recent version has, in comparison with the first version, I think is a much better way of doing it. And so I think that there's a good chance that in time we will do that with webcams. I'm personally excited about it, and when we get there, you'll all be the, you'll all know as soon as we're ready to talk about it. But I'm in favor of it. I think it's going to be at least a little while because we're not actively thinking about it, but we're also in the process of thinking about like what kind of fun stuff can we do to celebrate 25 years.
Yeah, that's coming up.
It sure is. It'll be here before we know it.
That's crazy. Do you have a favorite cache type yourself?
Favorite cache type? Yeah, I think so. I mean, my favorite cache type is probably megas and gigas, really, because I love being with geocachers out in the community and getting to talk to people and hear what how the game is impacting their lives and what it means to them and how they learned about it and how they're sharing it. And I would say like I'm an extroverted introvert. And so I really like being at those events. When they're over, like just leave me in the hotel room. I'll keep the TV off and I'll just like lie down and close my eyes for a few hours just to kind of recover. But when I'm at those events, like I'm always smiling and I'm really just so happy to be there. And it's easy because you get to meet people from all over the world, especially at the megas and gigas. You get to meet so many people and you get to really like see these are the people that we've been serving for 23 years, and to see like how are we doing? Are we doing a good job? Like, what else would you like to see? What can we change? What can we make better? It's a learning opportunity. It's a sharing opportunity. It's an opportunity where we just get to connect with people. And so that's really my favorite cache type of all of them. I do like the CETOs, particularly because the thought of doing something positive for the environment is something that is really it if it's not important to somebody, it should be important to somebody. You know, this is our this is the only planet we have right now. And so, like, as a community, the positive impact we can have on it is really important as well. And so seeing people, geocachers, get together to clean up trash, make the areas nicer, remove invasive species, like do things that are positive for the environment. That's really a lot of fun. And then, you know, I really like traditional caches. I do. I like puzzle caches. You know, some of the really, you know, when people put a lot of effort into the mechanical ones or the electronic ones, it's just an opportunity to witness the creativity of a global community. And that's something that's just so remarkable to see what people come up with, and just the amount of effort that they will put in to create something special for people that they don't even know. Like, it's remarkable. It's just very special. And so any chance I get to see that is, you know, it's a treat for all of us to get to experience like a really special cache. And yeah, so that's kind of the ones that really do it for me. How about you? You have a favorite?
You know, I really love a creative cache. Doesn't matter so much the type, if it's something really creative, just something different instead of, you know, a bison tube in a tree, which, you know, nothing wrong with those. There's a place for those. Some people absolutely love those, but, you know, if it, and it doesn't have to be a mechanical one or just something creative, something camouflaged well, something where some extra thought was put into it, or something that takes you to like in a really amazing place or like a little hidden gem. I've actually found a couple little monuments and landmarks around my town that I've been born and raised here. Never knew they were there until a geocache took me there.
I've had the same experience, like places in my own neighborhood that I was like, I've been living in the same neighborhood. I moved to Seattle a little over 25 years ago from New York. And, you know, I'm living here even, it was like 20 years. And we're out geocaching with my family. And I'm like, how did I not know that this park was walking distance from my house? Like, how did I not know? Like, it's almost absurd. And yet, I think geocachers in general, most of us have had that kind of experience where you really just find something or learn something that you would never have discovered otherwise. And it's another wonderful aspect of the game that it can do that for people.
Absolutely. What do you hope to see for the future of geocaching?
I hope to see more people getting outside, spending their time in nature, exploring, having adventures, you know, sharing community with one another. I want to see more of that. I would like to see us continue to evolve the game, you know, protect the core of the game, certainly, but take advantage of opportunities to evolve and build on top of it. You know, things like Adventure Lab, I think, holds a lot of promise because you know, there were things in sort of traditional geocaching that just we just couldn't do, private experiences. So, like, you know, we just got an email a couple weeks ago from a school teacher, and she said, "Hey, I'd really love to use geocaching to like create this historical experience in my town and teach my students about the history. Like, how can I do that?" And we're thinking, all right, well, you can place a series of caches, but you've got proximity in your town, you've got, you know, public and private. How long do you want to do this? Do you want to do it for, you know, in perpetuity, or do you want to do it for a couple of weeks? And if it's a couple of weeks, like, hey, time limited. You know, if you want to do it on school grounds, probably don't want random geocachers showing up on school grounds. Like, here's this platform that allows people to do things that they couldn't do with traditional geocaching, but they're tied together in certain respects. And so, you know, we decided years ago that this needed to be built, and we've invested heavily in the platform. And, you know, we're at, I think, 69,000 adventures worldwide, which is, you know, in terms of like self-guided tours and experiences, that's not easy to do. And again, we're not doing it all. We're building a platform, and then we're putting it in the hands of creative people around the world and saying, What do you want to do with this? And so, what's the next technology ask? What's the next innovation? And how can we think creatively about bringing that into the game or applying it to an aspect of the game that can serve to get more people inspired to go out and have those adventures and exploration and get together and just celebrate being outside together or celebrate being a community and, getting to know people, not just from their own neighborhood, but maybe from other states and other countries. It's good for people and it's actually good for the world to have more of that. So that's very much a part of what I'm hoping we can all collectively accomplish in the coming years. And I say collectively because it's not just Groundspeak. It's you, it's everybody who's got an idea for the next cache. It's the next people that are going to build an adventure lab. It's the Sunny and Sandy with their podcast, and it's Joshua Johnson with his vlogs and Wholesome on TikTok, and all the people that are contributing to this ecosystem. Together we can build the next version of this game, and we can extend it in ways that create more positivity and adventure exploration and community in the world.
Very cool. Is there anything that we haven't talked about that you'd like to share or want people to
There's so much that we
know?
have not talked about. There's so much. I could keep talking for a very long time. I guess I would say, as geocachers, we understand the power of this game to have a positive impact on people's lives around the world. It's very important that people can continue to play for free. And we, that is not something that's going to change. And so think about who else who probably could use a day outside, who could probably use an adventure or a moment of exploration, or maybe who doesn't have a sense of belonging in a community, and let them know that they're welcome and maybe show them how to play, because we have found that, the best success really comes from when we take our friends and family out and we say, "Hey, I want to show you this cool thing." And you don't have to play forever, but even if we have one positive day together, we've just given you a new memory. Or, and maybe it's something that you, like many of us, become kind of addicted to, and you like to play all the time, and then meet new people, meet new friends, develop a sense of belonging, understand that you are welcome to come join this global community of really good people all over the world. And then also, if you have the opportunity to travel, whether it's the next town over, the next state over, or even another country, when you go anywhere, find the local geocachers, because you have something to talk about. They'll take you out. They'll show you the cool spots in their neighborhood. And I know a lot of that is happening already, but some people feel like they need permission to ask. That's not the way it is with geocaching. I think we, as players, we really understand that, if you reach out and you say, "Hey, I'm going to be in such and such state, next week. Can somebody tell me, what are some caches I can find?" Like, invariably, people are going to say, "Well, here's a few of the best caches that you should go find." But also, you may likely find that people are like, "Hey, we're going out on this caching excursion on this day. Why don't you come join us?" And that's the community that is really just so special. And I think that the world needs a lot more of that. And so let's go get everybody outside. One of the things that we say, we have a mission, vision, and values. And so our mission is to inspire outdoor adventure, exploration, and community. I know I said that already. Our vision is that everywhere is an adventure and everyone is an explorer. And that, obviously, it's aspirational, but together we can actually make more of that happen. The values are, passion, effectiveness, authenticity, and inclusiveness. And the inclusiveness is really this game does not belong to Groundspeak. We don't own geocaching. Nobody should ever own geocaching. We collectively, as a global community, own geocaching. And for us as a company, we recognize this, and we also recognize that we have to earn the right to be the global headquarters for this game through generous, effective service for the community. And that's our goal. And we expect to be held accountable for that. And that's the right way to do it. And so we're just excited for what comes tomorrow. And we're excited to have more people out, you know, playing and benefiting from this game and the relationships that it creates for everybody.
Sounds good. Did you have a cache you wanted to highlight?
My favorite cache in the entire world is GCK25B, and that is the HQ headquarters cache. It has been found over 20,000 times, and it's in our visitor center. And so if you haven't been here, and this is for you and your audience and anybody else who is listening, come visit us. We have a visitor center and there's a lot of really cool stuff to see, but it's also an opportunity. Like when I see people in the visitor center, I always want to go out and say hello and talk to them and like events, find out like, what about geocaching do you like? What don't you like? You know, what's inspiring you? How is this affecting your life? And what I have seen over many years is just profoundly positive impact on so many people. And so having this as a destination, and in Fremont where our office is, there's geo tours and adventure labs and you know, many caches around to do. So it's a little bit of just sort of a fun place to visit. But the HQ cache has always been really special because it represents like, that's an invitation to the world to say, come visit us, come say hi. And we've had visitors from most countries in the world over the years. And, you know, if you haven't been here yet, you know, studio audience, audience at home, come on out and visit us. We'd love to see you.
Now, I've heard some cashers say they wish that they could claim the fine on HQ multiple times. Is that ever something that you would archive and put back out there for people to find again?
Probably not, because you know it's I think it's inconsistent with like the ethos of the game.
Yeah,
you know, it's like, hey, if you come to HQ, you find this cache, you found the HQ cache, you know, do you want to say I found it again? And to be fair, like, we've had a cache in our lobby slash, you know, it's a visitor center now. In the early days, it was a lobby. This is the third or fourth office where we've had a cache that people could come visit. It's the same GC code because it's not about specifically where you're at. It's really about like, hey, you've come to visit us at HQ. And so, you know, archiving it, like, why would we ever archive the HQ cache? Just the history alone, looking at that cache page and knowing, you know, it's been 20, I think we hit 20,000 visitors sometime in like October of last year. I announced it at our all company meeting because it was like 2 days before that. And it was just a cool milestone. I don't even know what it's at now, but it's something more than that because we have visitors almost every day. And, you know, you could always write a note, you know, if you want to say, yeah, hey, I came back again. But it's like, if you find a cache, you get a fine for the cache.
Yeah.
You know, there's no real reason to archive it and replace it. I don't think so anyway.
Oh, Brian, thank you so much for joining me today and talking with me about geocaching. This has been a lot of fun. I really appreciate you taking the time to do it.
It is my pleasure, and thank you for inviting me to come on the show. And thanks for what you're doing to spread the word about geocaching. As I said, you know, this is an effort from all of us, and you know, it's something for everybody to be proud of. And so thanks for the contribution that you're making to the global community and to outdoor adventure and exploration. It is greatly appreciated by all of us here at HQ, as well as all of the community outside of HQ.
Well, thank you.
You're welcome.
Welcome to Geocache Adventures, the podcast where we explore everything geocaching. I'm your host, Shadow Dragon One. I love geocaching. If you're listening to this, you probably love it too. If you enjoy the podcast, consider sharing it with somebody that you think would love it. You can also follow the podcast on Instagram and Facebook, and there's a Facebook group as well, so you can join in the fun and share your adventures. There's also a Patreon page that you can join and unlock exclusive content.